أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
To download more lectures, learn more about our project, and to help support it, visit www.bayyinah.com/dream. That's BAYYINAH/dream. You are free to share these recordings with family and friends. Thank you and Jazakumullahu khairan for helping us make our dream a reality.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والنازعات غرقا والناشطات نشطا والسابحات سبحا فالسابقات سبقا فالمدبرات أمرا يوم ترجف الراجفة تتبعها الرادفة قلوب يومئذ واجفة أبصارها خاشعة يقولون أئنا لمردودون في الحافرة أئذا كنا عظاما نخرة قالوا تلك إذا كرة خاسرة فإنما هي زجرة واحدة فإذا هم بالساهرة. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. ثم أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله تعالى we're beginning our study of سورة النازعات today. The first comment very briefly that we'll make is that it's a Makki surah, just like the surah before it, Surah An-Naba. And we're going to try to understand the conclusion of Surah An-Naba connected to the introduction to Surah An-Nazi'at. Towards the end of Surah An-Naba, the surah right before this one, Allah Azza wa Jal said, يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفًّا لَا يَتَكَلَّمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَقَالَ صَوَابًا ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ الْحَقِّ. There was reference over and over again to the final day, the last day. That's the conclusion of Surah An-Naba. Right after the introductory comments of this surah are done, we go back to the last day again. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةُ تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةُ قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ. Again يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةُ أَبْصَارُهَا خَاشِعَةُ. And we get to these ayat, inshallah, we'll see the commentary on them. But it seems like it's a continuation with a small lapse. It's again a continuation of that final day. How the previous surah concluded is tied to the introduction of this surah. Now, in the beginning of the surah, there are a series of oaths, aqsam. And this is a dedicated subject in the Qur'an, al-aqsam fil Qur'an al-hakim. Allah Azza wa Jal, He swears by things. So before we talk about these oaths particularly, we need to understand some fundamental things about aqsam in the Qur'an, the oaths in the Qur'an. From among the tabi'un and the earliest of scholars, there has been commentary on the function and the wisdom of the oaths in the Qur'an. And one of the most common opinions has been that when Allah swears by something, it is something sacred or something powerful or something awe-inspiring. So for instance, Allah Azza wa Jal, He swears by the sun, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا, or by the moon, وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا, or by the morning, وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرْ, or by the bright morning, وَالضُحَى, or by the night, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. You know these famous oaths in the Qur'an, right? Or وَالْعَصْرِ, right? These are many, many, many cases of oaths in the Qur'an. One of the opinions of the tabi'un has been that these oaths have to do with something sacred. But that in and of itself is not enough. There's more to know about the oath than just that they are speaking of something sacred or honored by Allah Azza wa Jal. Actually, a contrary opinion also exists. For example, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, in his book Al-Mu'in fi Aqsam al-Qur'an, he dedicated himself just to the study of oaths in the Qur'an. And he says, just saying that the oaths are sacred isn't enough. Because when we have watini wa zaytun wa turi sinin wa hadha al-balad al-amin, these are oaths in one surah. And then you have some oaths in another surah, you know, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا. If the only thing to know is that they're sacred, then you could take the ones from here and put them there, and take the ones from there and put them here. What difference does it make? There necessarily has to be more to it than that. So he argues that actually the fundamental thing to know is not the sanctity of the object that is being sworn by, but rather how it connects to the rest of the surah. So when an oath is taken, it is an introduction. It's a powerful means of introducing a topic that is coming in the rest of the surah. And that's really how the entire precedent of the surah is set. For example, one of the biggest examples, or easiest to understand even, would be لا أقسم بيوم القيامة. Allah Azza wa Jalla in the beginning, He swears by two things. He swears by the day of resurrection, يوم القيامة, ولا أقسم بالنفس اللوامة, the blameworthy self. He swears by two things. When you study Surah Al-Qiyamah, you'll find only two things. You will find the mention of Al-Qiyamah, and you will find mention of the blameworthy self. كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةَ وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةَ etc. etc. Right? So these are only two things you're going to find in the entire surah connected to the introductory oaths that have been mentioned. So long story short, some other things that you should know about oaths. In daily speech, in people's common discourse, when is an oath used, especially in ancient times? It is used, one, when the audience that you're speaking to, they don't believe what you're saying. For example, when you speak to someone, you say to them, I was at this place yesterday. They don't believe you, you say, I swear I was there yesterday. Right? And even we do this nowadays, right? In the olden times, you had to swear by something to make yourself believable. So I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or something like this, right? Even the mushrikun would swear by other things. He would swear by his child, or by his tribe, or by his family, or by his health, right? That he was at such and such place. So it's a means of giving testimony, which is why even in contemporary society, people take an oath or they swear before they testify in court. They have to swear that they're telling the truth. This is one function of oaths. Another function of oaths is that it is an illustration of anger. Because the one who swears is someone who is not being taken seriously, or what they have to say isn't being given its full due, so they are brought to a point where they have to swear. In common language nowadays, we say to each other, man, I swear, you better stop. Right? We say something like that. And when do we say this? Is when the other person is making us angry. Or two friends maybe in an argument, and one of them might say, I swear I'm going to kill you if you don't do this, or if you do this, right? So they don't really mean it, but it's an expression of anger. In Quran, sometimes the oath is an expression of anger. Other times it is an expression of, subhanahu wa ta'ala, expression of the idea that what is being presented coming forward is not being taken seriously by most people. Whatever Allah is about to present, people are taking it lightly. So to give it importance and to make them realize this is a heavy thing, Allah Azza wa Jalla swears. So this is the second reason. And by the way, when I use swear, I don't use it in the modern sense. You know, in the modern sense, to swear is to use profanity, right? To use foul language. But I mean it in the sense of the ancient English, like to take an oath by something. Then finally, the oath as a consistent component of the Quran is necessarily an introduction or precursor to arguments that are coming in that surah, in that very surah. And that's what we're going to see here, inshaAllah ta'ala. For the very beginning oath, we have an-nazi'at, wa-nazi'ati gharqa. Allah swears by an-nazi', comes from nazi', which means to yank something out violently, to pull something out with full force. Okay, an-nazi'at, Allah swears by the ones that pull out. Gharqa, having dove in. Gharq here is maf'ul mutlaq, actually it's called. The grammatical term is maf'ul mutlaq min ghayri lafzihi, meaning it's used, the word gharqan is used to emphasize the act of pulling out without using the same root. Instead of saying wan-nazi'ati naz'a, it's wan-nazi'ati gharqa. And the idea is, whatever Allah is swearing by, these are some creatures or some object that dives deep in and yanks whatever is deep inside and pulls it out. The vast majority of the mufassirun in regards to what these things are, they mention that these are angels, the vast majority of them. And they're actually sourced in one opinion. Baghwi reports on behalf of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu that Ibn Abbas's opinion radiallahu anhu that the an-nazi'at and then an-nashitat and so on, all of the oaths here that have at the end, all of them are referring to angels. And that's become the popular opinion among the mufassirun. The second opinion about this is that these are an-nujum, that these are the stars that also exist. For example, Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, his opinion is that these are stars that Allah is speaking about, stars that are being yanked out of the sky or that are falling, which was from the experience of the Arabs when they would see a comet or something like that they would comment, this is nazar, right? It's been yanked out of the sky. Anyhow, the third opinion that I will present, inshallah, of these two, obviously the most popular one is the angels. That's probably the one you've already heard also. But there is a third opinion that I would like to share and then tie them all together, inshallah ta'ala. The thing we have to understand about Quran is sometimes the text is ambiguous. Allah Azza wa Jalla didn't spell out explicitly that these are angels. first that we should be honest and know that that is the case. Allah did not spell out specifically that these are angels. The second thing to note is when there are a variety of opinions, that especially in the first generation, that in itself is an illustration that this was ambiguous. That in itself is a proof that this is not something mutlaq, it's not absolute, it's not one way and everything else is kufr. So you find in the history of the Mufassirun, you have arguments supporting, okay, this is an opinion, what are the evidences that make this opinion stronger than that opinion? Or what are the evidences that this opinion is rather weak as opposed to other opinions? So even though these opinions exist, there are opinions among later ulama that critique these opinions and try to weigh, not just by popularity, but by what other supporting evidence is there to see what opinion is the strongest. So I will present you one such opinion. One such opinion is that an-nazi'at refers to the winds. That an-nazi'at refers to winds. The alif ta at the end has been used consistently in the Quran and other places which with strong linguistic evidence that it's also winds. Al-mursalat, wal-mursalati urfa, al-dhariyat, al-jariyat. There are many instances where the language suggests and the context suggests that they are in fact referring to winds. So one opinion is that it is referring to winds. But again, we already said, what's the most popular opinion? That it's the angels. So we have to try to figure out what criticism do these scholars have. For example, Islahi, rahimahullah, has the opinion that this is winds. What basis does he have? The first criticism that he offers is this, that an-nazi'at is the feminine plural. It's called jam' mu'annath salim, alif ta at the end. This is the feminine plural. And Allah Azza wa Jal in the Quran speaks against attributing femininity to angels. In the Quran itself, Allah speaks against attributing femininity to angels, and He speaks about those who attributed femininity to angels in one place, and another place, وَاتَّخَذَ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنَاثًا, has your Lord taken daughters, or from the angels He's taken these feminine creatures, right? So there's a criticism in the Quran of this. The second issue that he brings up is, when Allah does speak about angels in the Quran, what we find consistently is jam' مُذَكَّر سَالِم. We find munzalin, musawwimin, murdafin, yadribuna wujuhahum wa adbarahum, qalu. So you have these words that are all masculine in nature. When the polarity of angels is mentioned consistently in the Quran, we find the masculine. Another case is that Allah Azza wa Jal, even when He does say something like qalatil malaika, for those of you who know a little bit of Arabic, qalat is feminine, right? So even when that does occur, that's not because of femininity, that's because of jam' taksir, the broken plurals in Arabic. You use the feminine singular for them. So that's in the beginning. But after this, like if you say qalatil malaika, if you reverse it, you don't say al malaikatu qulna, you say al malaikatu qalu. So you use the masculine once again. Okay, so that's how it's found in the Quran. So that's his literary criticism, that in the Quran consistently the masculine is used. So why would this be angels if the feminine is being used? That's one criticism. The other criticism that's tied together with this is that, you know how Allah Azza wa Jal speaks about the soul being pulled out after the angels diving in gharqan, right? So that they're going into the body. But if you study the ahadith about the soul leaving, that the soul leaves from where, do you know? Where is it pulled out of? From the toe. And the imagery depicted and the depictions in the ahadith are of such that the angels are not entering the body, yet they are pulling the soul out of the body. So he argues this as a criticism of this position also. Furthermore, that it's not explicitly mentioned anywhere else. So we have both opinions now. We have a majority of ulama saying that this is angels, but also a pretty strong position that it's not, it may be something else. Now, how do you reconcile these two? This actually has to do with the versatility and the comprehensive nature of the message of the Quran. We have to understand, first and foremost, Meccan Quran is talking to who? Who is it talking to? It's talking to people that don't believe. It's the kalam that's coming out of the mouth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the angel has revealed to him. But the audience, the vast majority of them, are people that don't believe him. And when they hear these words, they're not going to come to him and say, give me tafsir of nazi'at. What is your opinion of what this means? They're not going to come. They hear this and they walk away. They take it for what at face value. So one of the most important considerations in interpreting Meccan Qur'an especially, is when we use when these words were used in the Qur'an, what was going on in the head of the mushrik Arab? How did he understand these words? How was he processing this information? And that is probably, if you want to understand the methodology of da'wah in the Qur'an, that takes precedence. This doesn't nullify the other opinions, because it may have relevance for us as Muslims in a more spiritual sense, in a deeper sense, and for the mushrik perhaps in a more shallow sense, but still it has some relevance to him.
And maybe the first thing that doesn't come to the mushrik's mind is angels. The last thing you want to think is that the mushrik heard Quran and they said, what is that talking about? I don't get it. No, the Quran was very relevant da'wah to the mushrik. It was directly talking to him. And this is what baffled the mushrikun, that it was speaking to them in clear, bilisanin arabiyin mubin, in clear and clarifying Arabic speech. So one more example of this before we go on to just wrap this subject up, inshallah. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا. He knows what enters into the earth and what comes out of the earth. When the mushrik hears that, what's he thinking? He's thinking of the rain going into the earth and the plant coming out of the earth. This is as far as his imagination goes. But when the believer hears that, there's more going on. There's deeper knowledge. And the deeper knowledge is, no, we also will go into the earth and we will also be coming out of the earth. So it's the same statement, but people are understanding it at different depths. So these are not contradictory statements I'm putting before you. These are at different levels, or different audiences are getting different levels of the same statement, appreciating different things. So Islahi's argument and others, basically the summary of it is, this is perhaps how the mushrik processed it. He thought of the winds. And then how would he then understand the rest of the message of the surah? But we keep the interpretation of the angels still, of course, as valid and majority. Anyhow, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَ. Finally, the evidence that is suggested among some scholars that this is referring to the winds is Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ رِيحًا صَرْصَرًا فِي يَوْمِ نَحْسٍ مُسْتَمِرٍ تَنْزِعُ النَّاسَ. The word تَنْزِعُ in the Quran, to snatch and yank out and pull out, has been used for ريح, has been used for wind. So he uses this as further supporting evidence. Anyhow, so if it is winds, then what this means is Allah is swearing by hurricane or tornado winds that yank trees out of their roots or buildings out of their foundations, like it's digging deep into the ground and pulling them out, plucking them out right away, right? And on the other hand, if this is referring to angels, it's the angels that are diving deep into the body and they are pulling and ripping the soul out that wants to stay inside the body. This is the soul of the kafir. وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى. And then nasht in the Arabic language, it refers to undoing a knot without making any effort. It refers to undoing a knot without making any effort. Another way nasht is used is when you have a loose knot and you kind of leave the animal and it wiggles a little bit and kind of gets undone by itself without any effort. This is also where nashata is used. So this is maf'ul mutlaq, which means these winds or the angels, if it's referring to the angels, it's referring to angels that seamlessly enter the body and take out the soul. Very smooth process, like the undoing of a loose knot. No force necessary to apply. And if it's referring to the winds, it's referring to smooth breeze. The breeze that is a source of calm and peace and even pleasure on the face of the one experiencing it. So two contradictory kinds of wind, if this is wind, right? The winds that are a means of destruction and the winds that are a means of comfort and a means of even relaxation, of course, especially in desert life. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحًا. This, if referring to the angels, it's been interpreted as sabh, by the way, literally means to swim quickly or to swim in a rapid, smooth way. You know, you can swim and you're splashing and it's not smooth, but when you're swimming smoothly, then this is sabh, okay? So this perhaps is referring to the angels as they dive in and they're diving inside the body of the person. That's how some ulama have commented on this, that they swim into the body seamlessly and they're looking for the soul and they're going to pull it out. Others have commented, no, if this is the wind, these are the clouds that are swimming in the air, floating in the air by means of the clouds that are, or the winds that are pushing them. And then finally, فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَ. Then the word سَبَق is actually in the reference to race. When one thing is taking the lead over another, this is فَالسَّابِقَاتِ. And there's a thought there, if you notice, those of you that are following along. What this means is it's connected to wasabihat. So وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَا فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَا are together. The others are separated, and we already knew that there were opposites, right? وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَا وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَا were two very different kinds of wind, or very different kinds of angel situations. So they're separated by a wow. But وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَا فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَا is necessarily a process A and then B. A being وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَا, B being فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَا. So the angels are racing back, taking these souls, racing back for their judgment. Also the clouds, from the view of the Arab, he would see the clouds, some of them moving faster than others, some of them taking a lead over the others. So this was part of the view of the Arab. فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَا. And then finally, فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا. This is a very powerful statement and should be understood both ways. One in terms of the angels that we spoke of, and also in terms of the interpretation that it's wind. First of all, let's look at the word تَدْبِير. The word مُدَبِّرَات is an ism fa'il from the word تَدْبِير. تَدْبِير includes the meanings of planning, organization, executing a matter. It's complete, you know, execution. And it's similar, it has contrast with another word that will come in this surah, where Allah says, ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى. It's a similar word, but it's a different structure, and it creates a different kind of meaning. But for now, understand, تَدْبِير is thorough planning, thorough organization, thorough execution of a plan. So Allah is swearing by, again, fa, these sabihat, and fa-sabiqat, this continuing these three, that these are the ones that execute the command of Allah, amra. Amran being the command, maf'ul bihi here. So Allah swears by those who execute the command of Allah diligently in an organized fashion. If this is referring to the angels, it is the angels that are assigned different tasks by Allah Azza wa Jal, and they do a diligent, organized job of executing those commands. If it's referring to the clouds, as is the case in Surah Al-Mursalat, we find وَالنَّاشِرَاتِ نَشْرًا فَالْفَارِقَاتِ فَرْقًا. Okay? There also we find the winds, they distribute clouds in every direction. And these clouds are racing against one another. What else does the wind distribute? The wind also distributes dust and pollen. Also, by means of the winds, the clouds that are distributing, the clouds are going to bring rain. So if you think about it, winds are the means by which life is sustained on the earth. Everything you need for life on the earth is plant life. And plant life can't be sustained without pollen, which is, you know, is now delivered by wind. And on the other hand, the rain from the sky, without which plant life can't exist. That's the clouds are delivered by the wind. So Allah has executed this organized plan of delivering these clouds. Some places won't get any. Some places will be dried up and become places of death and famine. And other places will be flooded with water. Other places will turn into lush gardens. All part of an executed plan from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these plans being executed by means of the wind. So this is the other interpretation of فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا. There are other words for planning that we should know about that are used in the Qur'an. So we use the word تَدْبِيد here, مُدَبِّرَات. Then we find the word كَيْد also. Like Allah says, فَإِن كَانَ لَكُمْ كَيْدٌ فَكِيدُونَ. Right? Also we find وَكَذَلِكَ كِدْنَا لِيُوسُفَ. What's the difference between تَدْبِيد, which is planning, and كَيْد, which is also planning? كَيْد is actually a secret plan. The fundamental element in كَيْد is secrecy. So it's a plan which you don't want anybody else to find out about, because part of exposing it will be to spoil the plan. It won't be any good if it comes out in the open. Another word used for planning is makr. And makr has an element of conflict in it. A plan that necessarily has to do with retaliation against an enemy. And when Allah is used with makr, like وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ, it's only used in the retaliatory sense. Meaning whenever Allah mentions that He's planning against an opposing force, it's always mentioned that they took the first step. They did makr first. So وَمَكَرُوا first, and then وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. So there's a difference. We don't usually, normally, typically use makr with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless in that reaction to the makr that was done by the wrongdoer to begin with. Then finally, we have another word, hila. Hila like, وَالْوِلْدَانْ لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ حِيلَةً. Hila is a kind of plan that you make to... Nowadays, there's a lot of hila in society, by the way. It's a clever plan. It's a clever plan. The idea of which is to maximize one's benefit or minimize one's harm without breaking the law, but at least trying to bend it, manipulating the system, working around the system. So accountants are really good at hila, for example, during tax season, right? Some of the scholars spoke about hila in the ancient times, in the times of Islamic rule, that the person would give all of their wealth as a gift to their wife right before zakat season, and then they would gift it back to them after zakat season is done. So this was kind of, you know, working around the law. Don't get any ideas. But this was the kind of hila that was done before. Anyhow, so these are different kinds of plans. Allah Azza wa Jalla specifically mentions فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا here, which the word includes planning, execution, organization, diligence, and actually means taking a step back before you take an action, because it comes from دُبْر, which is the back of something. And it's to turn back from the affair, think it through, and then come back and can execute it. That's the interpretation of the word تَدْبِير. Anyway, now that Allah Azza wa Jalla has taken an oath by these few things, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا, by those who dive deep in and yank out, وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطًا, those who sail smoothly, like the undoing of a knot, then you know, فَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَا those who swim or float, you know, effortlessly, seamlessly, those who race one against one another diligently, and then finally those that plan the or execute the affair with thorough planning. After all of these oaths, Allah Azza wa Jalla moves on to another subject. And yes, last time we talked about the subject matter of Quran, paragraphs in the Quran, incredibly organized in the sense of even their rhyme scheme. So the first few were oaths in the Quran, and they all rhyme. So if you recite them, you will hear the rhyme scheme. وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا. Now if you look at the next few ayat, you'll just hear it even. Even if you don't read tafsir, you'll hear it. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةِ قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ. You hear the scheme, right? Because it's a united subject. So even phonetically, it's united, subhanAllah. Now we come to this next part, but before we do, understand that when an oath is taken, there's what you took an oath, but now you want to say something. Like, I swear by X, I'm going to do this. Now what that I'm going to do this part, what am I swearing by? What is the statement that I'm about to make? That is actually hadhf here, it's mahdhuf here, it's not mentioned. The reason it isn't mentioned is because this is a part of a series of surahs where it has been mentioned. And it forces us to look at the tafsir of this surah in surahs that are similar to it. So for instance, you find وَالْمُرْسَلَاتِ عُرْفًا فَالْعَاصِفَاتِ عَصْفًا وَالنَّاشِرَاتِ نَشْرًا فَالْفَارِقَاتِ فَرْقًا فَالْمُلْقِيَاتِ ذِكْرًا عُذْرًا أَوْ نُذْرًا. And then جَوَابَ الْقَسَمِ إِنَّمَا تُوْعَدُونَ لَوَاقِعٍ. All of those oaths were taken for what conclusion? No doubt about it, whatever you have been promised is bound to occur. Whatever you have been promised is bound to occur. That conclusion is understood here because it's part of that chain of discourse. It's understood that when they hear these oaths, the next thing to expect is resurrection. But Allah Azza wa Jalla doesn't spell it out, which has benefits. One of the benefits is it forces you to look at other texts in the Quran. Al-Quran yufassiru ba'dahu ba'dan. The other thing it forces to do is the person who hears oaths, they're expecting to hear, what are these oaths about? What's he going to talk about? So now they're in more anticipation of what is to come. But Allah doesn't give them what they were expecting, so they keep on listening. They're still haven't figured out what exactly is this thing about. So now Allah Azza wa Jalla speaks about the depiction of the day of resurrection. Here, before continuing, understand a contrast with Surah An-Naba. In Surah An-Naba, in the beginning we had عَمَّ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ عَنِ النَّبَإِ الْعَظِيمِ الَّذِي هُمْ فِيهِ مُخْتَلِفُونَ. You know, there was a depiction of the skeptic. They're asking each other, what is this, you know, when is this going to happen? And you know, Allah threatens them, they will soon find out. And then he starts talking about the hereafter. So he spoke of the skeptic first, and the hereafter second. In this surah, he reverses the sequence. Here he mentions the hereafter first, and he will mention the skeptic later. يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُودُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. That's later. So there's a reversal. This actually, in Arabic literature, is a mechanism called اللَّفْ وَالنَّشْعَ عَلَى الْعَكْسِ. That you fold something up, and then you unfold it in its reflection, or in the opposite. So you know how the mirror, if you put an object before the mirror, they're exactly the same except they're organized opposite. You lift your right hand, the mirror is lifting the left hand, etc. Right? So that's the idea here. One surah is organized one way, and this will do the flip organization of the ideas presented in Surah An-Naba in many ways, one of which is this. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ. Rajf in Arabic is related to some other words, inshallah. We'll discuss some of these words, bi'idhnillah. The first thing to note is, rajf has to do with rattling or shaking. Okay? And there are a bunch of words in the Quran for this. And it's important whenever you come to a word that has other synonymous terms in the Quran that you should highlight the differences between them. Because it gives clarity to one particular text over the other. Other words that are used in the Quran, for example, zalzala, إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زلزالها. The origin of that word is from zalla, which means, you know, when someone's feet slip. And zalzala, because of the repetition of the phonetics, you know, in the sounds, it actually alludes to repetition, meaning someone's feet keep on slipping. When does that happen? During an earthquake. That's why it's called zalzala, because one's feet keep on tripping up. So that's one. The other is zaj. Sorry. إذا رجت الأرض رجا. Right, when Allah Azza wa Jalla speaks about Raj. And this is actually an initial jerk. Like something was stationary, all of a sudden it was put into motion. This is Raj. Ulama comment that this is the first moment of the experience of an earthquake. That's Raj. That's the very beginning of the experience of the earthquake. Then we have Mara. يَوْمَ تَمُورُ السَّمَاءُ مَوْرًا. This is actually used when you are, for example, riding a horse, or you're running really fast, or somebody, a large animal passes by you running fast, and it simulates the feeling of an earthquake. It's not really an earthquake, but everything's shaking because of the rapid motion. That is called mara. Finally, we come to the word that's used in this ayah. Allah says, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. When that which is meant to rattle, rajifa, the rattling one, will eventually rattle. Allah Azza wa Jal did not here mention the earth. In another place in the Quran, Allah says, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الْأَرْضُ وَالْجِبَالُ. تَرْجُفُ الْأَرْضُ وَالْجِبَالُ وَكَانَتِ الْجِبَالُ كَثِيبًا مَهِيلًا. The day on which the land, the earth, and the mount, and you know the large boulder mount, they are going to rattle. They're going to shake and vibrate, as though they were كَثِيبًا مَهِيلًا, that they were sand dunes. When you shake a pile of sand, the sand keeps tripping over and falling off, right? As though they were that soft. That's how the earth is going to shake that Allah describes. Imagine salt in a salt shaker, basically. That's the image that Allah depicts. But there he said, the earth and the mountains are going to shake. Here he said, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الْأَرْضُ وَالْجِبَالُ. No, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الْرَاجِفَ. الْرَاجِفَ means that which is meant to shake. What this illustrates is the purpose of the creation of the heavens and the earth. Its final destination is the point where it's going to shake. It's going to be rattled. This is its destiny. It can't be avoided. So much so that it's called الْرَاجِفَ. It's so much so that the fa'il isn't al-ard wal-jibal, that it's rajifa itself. So it's a profound declaration in the Quran about the reality of that shaking. Finally, just a comment about the word rajaf. It's a highly uncomfortable motion. And it actually doesn't just depict the motion itself, it depicts the state of the one who is affected by that motion, that they're in a state of discomfort and disarray. Now, يَوْمَ تَرْجَفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ. Then Allah says, تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةِ. It will be followed by a radifa. Radif in Arabic implies, you know, when you're riding a camel or a horse and somebody's sitting behind you, then they are radif. They're riding behind you. People sitting in the back seat in your car nowadays, they're radif. They're following right along. Wherever you go, they're going because they're on the same ride. So Allah Azza wa Jal mentions that there's going to be, it'll be followed by another vibration, another jerking, another violent movement, one successively following the other, one meant to follow the other. A lot of the ulama are pretty much in agreement on this radifa, this following shaking and vibrating, that this, the first one is when the first time the trumpet will be blown. You know, in the previous surah we said, وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ, right? We've heard those words. And now that's being opened up. There's a tafsir of the previous text in the next surah. Okay? So now, how many times will the trumpet be blown? Twice. The first one, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. Then the second one, تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَ. So there's a long gap between them, but they are one to succeed the other. When one comes necessarily, the other's on its way. Radif literally implies, like we said, to sit behind. And you know, when words come one after another in meaning, that they're very close to each other in meaning, but they're not exactly the same, but they're still very close, they're called mutaradif. So synonyms in Arabic are called mutaradifat, for example. That's because they're very close to one another. Other words that speak of following in the Quran are khalfa. Khalfa actually refers to when you follow something chronologically, meaning something came, then thereafter something else came, that's khalf. Radif, literally right behind, like we said, situated behind and moving along with. Then we have tala, which is to follow something carefully and repeatedly. Like for example, it's used for the sun and the moon, because the sun and the moon follow a path repeatedly. Anyhow, قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ. Allah says, first of all, the earth will violently shake when the trumpet is blown. And then the second time, it will be shaken another time. And this other time is when we will be raised. The first one was for death, and the second one is for resurrection. So now, on the time of this resurrection, Allah depicts the first thing. He says, قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ. Hearts on that day, and actually قُلُوبٌ, by mentioning it first, and not putting al on it, which is normally the case in Jumla Ismiya, by not putting al on it, there's an interesting nuanced meaning that's generated. Some hearts on that day, some hearts particularly on that day, will experience what Allah depicts as wajifa. Here, I know this is a long list, but I still want to illustrate this list, or at least express some of the meanings in this list before you, before we go into the word wajifa, because it's critical for you to appreciate the depth of the words in Arabic. One of my agendas in these durus is to try to highlight how incomplete translations are. How incomplete, even my own translation, how incomplete it is. Because how deep the words go and how intricate the meanings are connected to one another, and we have to be careful in coming to conclusions about the tafsir of Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla speaks about the word wajif, and most translations will say petrified, horrified, you know, terrified, scared. These are the words, basically words associated with fear. Now here's some words in the Quran that are used for fear, just so we know how they're different. One of the words used for fear is khawf. Khawf, you probably heard this word before, it's a very famous word. لا خوفٌ عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. Khawf is used for a perceived danger. When you actually perceive a physical danger, then the word used is khawf. Another word is khashya. Like ولا تقتلوا أولادكم خشية إملاق. Okay, خشية is used when you are afraid of the magnitude of something. Specifically out of the magnitude of whatever is coming, that is scaring you, that is خشية. So khawf is more of a physical danger. While khashya is a the greatness of something, like the magnitude of the implications of losing one's job, or the magnitude of the idea of Day of Judgment will lead you to khashya, for example. Then there's the word khushu', which we use, for example, also in salah. This is a fear that's manifest not only in your heart, but it actually takes a hold of your face and your limbs. This fear shows on your face and your limbs. It's an overpowering and an instilling kind of fear. And this is the kind of fear we're supposed to have in salah. That it actually, our faces have khushu', not just our hearts. That khushu' comes out of the heart and it starts affecting other limbs of the body. Then there's the word taqwa, which is very common. Ittaqa yattaqi. This is to actually fear the consequences of one's actions. To fear not something dangerous, but the consequences of what I'm doing myself. This is actually called taqwa. It comes from wiqaya, which is to protect. And taqwa literally means to protect yourself from the consequences of your own future actions. Okay, that's how it's really, in the literary sense, it's understood. Then there's hadr, like hadar al-maut, right? They are a fear of death. Again, the translation will say hadr means fear. But hadr is actually to, out of fear, to try to escape something or to be very careful of something. If you see something scary and trying to kind of escape it, this is hadr. This is that specific kind of fear, which means you're in proximity of the thing that is dangerous or the thing that you're trying to get away from. Then there's ra'a, to startle someone. When you jump up on somebody or you show up out of nowhere or the person was just reading and they unexpectedly heard the door open, the initial reaction is rawa. This is this fear immediate, but it subsides immediately also. This is the kind of fear that Ibrahim alayhi salam first felt when the angels came, but it departed from him. It left from him. This is raha. Okay. Then there's awjasa, or wajas it comes from. And this is actually a fear when you hear something. You know, like you hear something, you get scared. Or you hear something that scared you. You hear some news or some event you overheard and it scared you. This is awjas. Also means to actually hide your fear within you. You don't let the person that is scaring you or the thing that is scaring you know that you're actually scared. Okay. Nakarahum wa awjasa minhum khifa. This is actually spoken of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Nakarahum. He saw them, he didn't recognize them, he didn't know who these guys are. So he was kind of scared, but he didn't let them see that he was scared. So awjasa is used. He didn't let them see his fear. Then there's wajil. You know, إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Wajil is used. Now wajil is to have a fear that penetrates deep into your heart. A fear that penetrates into the very depths of your heart. That's wajil. Rahab is a fear mixed with, you know, it's actually mixed with love. So it's a kind of fear you have of disappointing the one you love. When you're afraid of disappointing the person that you love, then rahab is used. Allah Azza wa Jalla speaks, for example, of believers saying, يَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا. They call on us with inclination, they're inclined towards their Lord, and they're also afraid. But what kind of fear? The fear of disappointing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's rahab. Okay? Then finally, ra'ab actually to be overwhelmed with intense fear. This is وَقَذَفَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمُ الرُّعْبَ. Also, ru'b comes from this, right? To have overwhelming, terrified fear of someone that makes you lose your reason. Then, ashfaqa, this is the kind of fear all of us have. This comes from, it's actually related to the word shafiqa ala. To have, you know, shafqa over someone is to take care of them, to be concerned with their well-being, etc. Right? To show good to them. But then ashfaqa means that you're afraid that some harm will come to them. The one you're taking care of, you're also scared that some harm might come their way. So many different kinds of fear illustrated in so many different places where it's best situated in the Quran. Of all of these, finally, we come to the word wajaf, which is قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ. That's the word that's used here. What is special about this kind of fear? It is a fear mixed with discomfort. And it actually, it's illustrated, the one who's feeling wajaf is the one whose heart is pounding so hard they can feel it out of fear. That's when wajaf is used. And this is also used when you strike your horse and its heart starts pounding and it races forward. So you say awjaftul khayla. I made my horse race forward by making its heart race. So that's the kind of fear that Allah depicts on that day. When that second strike will fall, when that second shaking will occur, some hearts on that day will be basically beating out of their chests. That's the illustration here. قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ. Especially on that day, some hearts will be beating out of their chests. The language, the sentence structure here also illustrates that these hearts right now, they're not scared. Right now they're at peace. They have no discomfort at all. But these are the very same hearts, especially on that day, يَوْمَئِذٍ, they're going to experience this wajifa. And also wajifa is an ism fa'il, it's a nominal form. What that illustrates is, you know when your heart starts pounding, a few minutes later it comes to rest, it calms down. The choice of the word in the ayah illustrates their heart will start pounding and it won't come to rest. It'll continuously keep pounding. It'll keep, the terror won't subside. قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةٌ. Then Allah says something beautiful. He says, أَبْصَارُهَا خَاشِعَةٌ. Again, depicting the terror of that day. Sometimes Allah depicts the terror of that day by things that are going to happen on that day, like the sun and the moon's collision and big, big things. Sometimes He depicts the terror of that day looking at the person and how scared they are. Not at the scary things that are happening, but their reaction to those things. So this is a surah that's highlighting more so the reaction to the events of the Day of Judgment of this person. Allah says, أَبْصَارُهَا خَاشِعَةٌ. Their vision, the visions of those hearts, or the eye, there here refers to the hearts, not the people, because it's not absaruhum, it's absaruha. What this tells us is that the vision is directly connected to the heart. That's a very important reality to understand. What you see and how you perceive what you see is directly affected by what you have in your heart. When you have iman in your heart, what you see will be a reminder for you. When you feel the wind, when you see the sun, when you see the clouds, you'll get a reminder out of them. When you don't have iman in your heart, those same eyes will do nothing for you. So now on that day, people will not see except from a believing heart, because now iman is haqqul yaqeen and ayn al yaqeen. They've seen it. So now those hearts, those eyes that are connected to these hearts now that are petrified, what's going to happen to those eyes? Khashi'ah. They will be overpowered, overwhelmed, humbled. Their muscles be relaxed. So these eyes will be overwhelmed by the fear that is going to be presented before them. Now this was the state of these some hearts that don't feel any fear now, but they will fear this terrifying day then. Now immediately there's an iltifat, there's a transition. And this transition illustrates irony. The irony of the whole thing is, as it stands now, يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُودُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. They say, a rough translation, they say, is it really the case that we're going to be returned to the original state? We're going to come back to life as we are now? Right back where we started is the expression we use in English, that's for hafira. If somebody says, for example, in Arabic, فُلَانٌ رَجَعَ إِلَى حَافِرَتِهِ or فِي حَافِرَتِهِ, this is an expression in ancient Arabic. This person came back right where they started. So when they hear this whole thing about us coming back to life, our hearts pounding, then the first reaction they have is, oh come on, we're going to come back right to this again? We're going to be back here again? Some of the scholars commented on the word hafira, which is an important word here, but a couple of things here. Number one, the word mardud. Inna la marduduna. Are we really going to be returned? But this rad refers to a kind of return when you go somewhere and you weren't accepted and you were returned. Like you tried to cross the border and they didn't accept your paperwork and they sent you back. This is rad. So they're saying we're going to be rejected and sent back like this, like our death wasn't acceptable enough, now we have to be brought back to life. This is a means of sarcasm of the disbeliever. Then he says al-hafira. Al-hafira is literally from hafr, which is a ditch in the ground that you dig. Okay, or mihfar is actually a shovel. That's how it's used. So they're basically saying, the imagery in language, you have to understand imagery in classical Arabic is, when you don't dig the ground, it's the way it's supposed to be. And then you make all this effort of digging it. And then you are asked to bring it back exactly where it used to be, back to normal again. So they're saying, come on, it's already, our graves are dug, we're set the way we are, we're not going to come out of this now. It's done deal. إِنَّا لَمَرْدُودُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. This resurrection after death doesn't seem like it's a very possible prospect. إِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا نَخِرَةً. And it might have been possible, maybe I just died, right? My muscles are still intact, the only thing is I'm not breathing anymore, right? Maybe in a couple of hours, maybe somebody's able to revive me, I'll still might believe it. But you're talking about the time, أَإِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا نَخِرَةً, even at the time when our bones will have been decayed to the point, nakhir means that the bone will be empty on the inside from decay. All that's left is a shell and air passes through it, right? And produces a smelly kind of an experience. When we're reduced to that much decay, you're saying we're going to be raised again? أَإِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا نَخِرَةً قَالُوا تِلْكَ إِذًا كَرَّةٌ خَاسِرَةً. Now notice, before we said يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُدُونَ. يَقُولُونَ is the present tense. They say and they will say. But قَالُوا is past tense. What this illustrates is this statement that we're about to read about was only made once or twice. It's lesser in its frequency. Okay, because al-madi yadullu ala al-huduth. Past and present in nowadays, when you hear past tense, you think of the past. When you hear present tense, you think of the present. In classical Arabic, past, present, future tense, they had different functions, not just timelines. They actually served the function of something being a one-time thing and something being a continuous thing. If it's a one-time thing, past tense. If it's continuous, present tense. For example, we find when Allah speaks about murder, you know, there are two kinds of murder, simply speaking. There's the guy who killed somebody by accident, and there's the guy who committed, you know, murder on purpose, homicide. So there's, you know, there's manslaughter, which is kind of by mistake, and homicide, which is on purpose. When Allah spoke of manslaughter, when you kill somebody by mistake, He said, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ مُؤْمِنًا خَطَأً. Whoever killed, past tense, killed a believer by mistake. When He speaks about killing on purpose, He says, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا. Whoever kills a believer on purpose. So what's the difference? The one who kills on purpose might do it again. There's going to be continuity. And may have done it before, so the present tense is more appropriate. And when the past tense is used for singular event, so the one who killed by mistake, chances are he's not going to do it again. He's not going to come back in 2 weeks and say, guess what, I made another mistake. That's not likely. So qatala is used. Here qalu illustrates that some of them actually gave this some thought. They actually gave this some thought. Though, even though they said this in a sarcastic tone, it illustrates that some of them did reach the conclusion, if there's a slight possibility that what you're saying is the truth, that we will be revived from death again, if that is even the slightest possibility, then they made the statement, تِلْكَ إِذًا كَرَّةٌ خَاسِرَةٌ. Then this is going to be a karrah, a return that is full of loss, خَاسِرَةٌ. A return full of loss. It's going to be a terrible return. Now, karra, the word literally doesn't just mean return. It actually, in Arabic, it's also used for attack. So this will be an attack on us. You know, the Arabs used to say, there was one of the military strategies they had was called karra wa farra. What that means is you attack and you run away. Then you attack later and you run away. Right? This was a military strategy. So karra here, not just a return, but this will be an attack against us that's going to cause a lot of damage to us. Now they're saying this in a sarcastic tone, but it actually illustrates at least they entertained the idea. At least once somebody entertained the idea that if this does happen, we will in fact be in very big trouble. قَالُوا تِلْكَ إِذًا كَرَّةٌ خَاسِرَةٌ. Now Allah ends all of this discourse. All of this in Surah An-Naba, the way Allah ended that discourse was كَلَّا سَيَعْلَمُونَ ثُمَّ كَلَّا سَيَعْلَمُونَ. Allah ended, He said, no, not at all. They're going to find out. We read about those ayah. Now Allah ends this discourse in another way. There He yelled at them directly saying they will find out. Here He says, فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ زَجْرَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. Then it's only going to take one yelling. Zajra really nowadays is, you know, when a parent is yelling at their child, this is zajra. There are different kinds of yelling, but when it's very loud and it's offensive to the one you're yelling at, then zajr is used. You know, it's used against the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَقَالُوا مَجْنُونٌ وَزْدُجِرٌ. Right, that they said he's insane, and he was yelled at in order to make him run away. Like they started howling at him and cussing at him, ma'adullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that he would run off and not give them da'wah anymore. That's the ayah, wazdujir. But here zajra is used. Zajra literally in the meaning of Allah Azza wa Jal will basically scold them, and that scolding will be enough. Some have commented that this zajra is the blowing of the second trumpet. That in itself is a scolding. That's all it's going to take. Zajratun wahida, فَإِذَا هُمْ بِالسَّاهِرَةِ. Then, as a consequence, we know it's consequence because fa is fa sababiyya. It illustrates consequence. Then, as a result, إِذَا, all of a sudden, هُمْ بِالسَّاهِرَةِ, they are going to be at this place that is in Arabic illustrated as a sahira. Let's talk briefly about what sahira means. Sahira literally means that your sleep has disappeared. It's dissipated. You can't sleep anymore. And it was used in reference to an open field. So the Arab, imagine, is traveling and there's this open field as far as the eye can see. He's got nowhere to rest, so he sticks his bag on the ground, he lies down. But you know, when you can see far in the distance, he's worried if he goes to sleep, somebody will see him from a distance, come and rob him and run off. So he loses his sleep because he's not hidden. He's too exposed. So sahar was used in the reference of an open field and also in the sense of losing one's sleep, because the two things are related to the Arab, to the Arab experience, okay? So now Allah speaks, they will be in this place where they will lose their sleep. Sahar also, it will be an open field. Here are some comments that the ulama have made about it. One is, we talked about the open field. Also, it's referred to as a mirage. Like one traveling in the desert and they see a mirage, and what do they see in the mirage? Water, right? So when you're almost asleep out of exhaustion in the travel of the desert, but you see a possibility of water in front of you, what happens to your sleep? It disappears. Now you can't sleep because now there's a goal in front of you. So some have commented sahara is used for this reason. Others have said this is actually the field or the opening. And sahara literally is a kind of ground that is pale, it's crusty, it's one color, almost white, and it's flat, completely flat, as far as the eye can see. This is a sahara. And some have commented this is actually the field and the land in which all human beings will be gathered for resurrection. So فَإِذَا هُمْ بِالسَّاهِرَةِ. Immediately they will be at the location of a sahira. In Tafsir Haqqani, we find one additional comment on this ayah. He says that this is like losing your sleep coming out of the grave. That as soon as that trumpet is blown, you will come out of your grave and lose your sleep forever. Because you know, in another place in Surah Yasin, for example, مَنْ بَعَثَنَا مِنْ مَرْقَدِنَا. Who has raised us from our place of sleep? Right, this has been used. So now their sleep is gone forever. Their sleep has been lost forever. Because once the paradise comes and the hellfire comes and the day of judgment comes, there's no more sleep. There's no more partial death. There's no escape from either the pleasures or the tortures. So فَإِذَا هُمْ بِالسَّاهِرَةِ. هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى. Complete shift of subject. You had in the beginning a few oaths regarding the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially in regards to the winds. We talked about last time a little bit about why the winds are important. I'll recap some things. The winds are critical because the Arab said, what's this hereafter, this whole unseen punishments that you talk about that seems so far off? The closest thing to the unseen in the seen world is the wind. The closest thing that we can experience but we can't see is the wind. And Allah illustrates His power of destruction and His mercy by means of the wind. Some winds come and destroy entire towns. Other winds come and they are the means by which entire life on the earth is sustained, right? So basically the idea is Allah doesn't need to make special arrangements for the kafir to bring some special military arrangement to bring him to punishment. All Allah needs to do is unleash His wind. That's enough for him. So whose power are you questioning? That's the idea of the winds being used as an oath. Then you come forward, Allah Azza wa Jalla started talking about the day itself. The day on which what your state of affairs is going to be. Watch what you're saying. Before Allah even mentions what He says, your hearts are going to be like that day. By the way, you seem to be talking, you know, all this trash now. يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُودُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ أَإِذَا كُنَّا عِذَامٍ نَخِرَةٍ قَالُوا تِلْكَ إِذَا كَرَّةٌ خَاسِرَةٌ. Now, all of this Allah brings to an end, takes us back to judgment again. فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ زَجْرَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ فَإِذَا هُمْ, all of them together, بِالسَّاهِرَةٌ. Now, you're not the first ones to rebel. You're not the first ones to be skeptics. You're not the first ones to poke fun at the truth and make smart comments. Allah turns His attention to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do we know He turned His attention to the Messenger? هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى. Did the news of Musa come to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This iltifat, what this illustrates is, imagine there's an audience in front of us, right? Allah Azza wa Jalla is speaking. There's one of the audience is the believers. One of the audience is the disbelievers. Part of the audience is the Messenger himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine there's a teacher. I'll put it in human terms. Imagine there's a teacher. He's got in the auditorium, there's a section A, there's a section B, there's a section C, and there's the TA standing next to him, right? Sometimes the teacher is talking to A, sometimes he's talking to B, sometimes he's talking to C, sometimes he's talking to the TA. Sometimes, for example, A did really well on the exam. So he's talking to B and he says to B, you know, you guys should be more like A, right? So he's not talking to A, but he's talking about them, even though everybody's listening. Sometimes he's telling his TA, don't worry about them, I know they're getting rowdy now, but you should relax, we'll get them under control, or something. In other words, the true instructor, the true teacher, has different audiences in different scenarios of education. Allah says about Qur'an, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ He taught the Qur'an. And these are components of teaching. You talk to someone, when they're being bad students, when they're not listening, these people are poking fun, now Allah turns to Musa alayhi salam and starts talking to him instead. Even though they're still listening, they learn now that Allah is no longer addressing them. He's tired of talking to them, pretty much in this discourse. So he turns to the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى The word hadith, which is interesting, Allah didn't say khabar, or Allah didn't say, you know, naba, or other words that are used in other places, hadith specifically. Hadith is used for something that is manifest, one. It is also used for something so old, and it's forgotten, that when you're reminded of it, it sounds like it's new, altogether new. And what the power of that word here is, when Allah says, did the hadith of Musa come to you? In other words, roughly translated, did the news of Musa come to you? You are being reminded of his legacy, and you will feel like this is the first time you're hearing it. That's how relevant it is to this discussion. That's how relevant it is to this discussion. That's why the word hadith is used. So did the hadith and the event of Musa, didn't it already come to you? إِذْ نَادَاهُ رَبُّهُ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ طُوَى When his Lord called unto him. Nida in Arabic is to call someone loudly. So when his Lord forcefully called him, with a tremendous voice, he called him. بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ In the sanctified valley, التَّقْدِيسِ in Arabic, like we do taqdis of Allah. وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ For example, right? Taqdis is to speak of Allah in a way that is appropriate of Allah. And to remove from Allah any attributions that are not appropriate to Him. Muqaddas is a place, it can be a place that is specified for declaring the perfection of Allah. A place that is specially arranged, specially designed to exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, in simple English words, a holy place, right? Or a sanctified place is probably a better term. So bilwadi al-muqaddas, in the sanctified valley of Tuwa. Already there's a parallel. Remember, Allah is talking to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah's Messenger called His Lord without Him even realizing, He called Him to the cave of Hira. He called Him to that cave and He gave Him revelation. Here He reminds Him, Musa alayhi salam was called to the valley of Tuwa. Why, for what? For revelation. And then the revelation was given, اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى. Go to Fir'aun. Go to Fir'aun. Now, in other places we find, فأتيا فرعون. Go approach Fir'aun all the way. Here it says, اذهب إلى, go to, head in that direction, meaning get started on your mission. The إلى here illustrates, just get started on this mission right away. Okay? So, who is the messenger to go to? He's to go to Quraysh. He's to go to the disbelievers, just like Musa alayhi salam was to go to Fir'aun. Now, why was he to go to Fir'aun? إِنَّهُ طَغَى No, there is no doubt that he has engaged in an act of rebellion. طُغْيَان in Arabic is used when, for example, if you have a pot, and you fill water in, but you put too much in and it starts spilling out, this is tughyan. Tughyan is used for oceans when they start boiling over, like a flood. This is tughyan also. So there are limits set on a human being of the things they can do and say. When they cross those limits, they have engaged in tughyan. So he's done tughyan in two ways that we learn of in Quran. First, he declared himself Rabb. Second, he enslaved Bani Israel. Because when Musa alayhi salam came to him, he addressed these two things. إِنَّا رَسُولُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ أَنْ أَرْسِلْ مَعَنَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ So these are the two great acts of rebellion of Fir'aun. Anyhow, so go to Fir'aun, he has rebelled, just like you people have rebelled. What this actually illustrates is, your problem really isn't that you don't believe in the hereafter, or you're skeptical. Your real problem is, just like was illustrated in the previous surah, your real problem is your love of rebellion. You don't want any limits put on you. You don't want to be told you can do this, you can't do this, you can live like this, you can't live like this. These are putting limits on you, and you love your rebellion, your free lifestyle. Nowadays we call it freedom. We love our freedom, right? And a carefree lifestyle. This is what you're really in love with, and that was the crime of Fir'aun before you. إِنَّهُ طَغَى فَقُلْ And we'll conclude with this ayah, inshallah, and conclude the surah after the salah. فَقُلْ هَلْ لَكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّى Then say to him, and this statement is very powerful. هَلْ لَكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّى The closest thing to it we can figure in English, هَلْ لَكَ مَيْلٌ First of all, there's a word understood here. Do you have any inclination inside you at all that you want to cleanse yourself of the filth that you are infested with? Do you have any voice of reason inside you that wants to make you a better person? Meaning the messengers, you know, their mission was, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ And other places, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ Tazkiya, purification, was one of the core components of the work of the messengers. What does tazkiya mean, purification? It is to take the elements of one's personality that are flaws, that are evil, that are rebellious, and to cleanse oneself of them. So the question to ask Musa, that Musa alayhi salam asks Fir'aun, is the same question that is now to be put to the people who fear or who don't fear the hereafter. The real question is, do you find any voice of reason, any conscience deep buried inside yourself that tells you that you should become a better person? Is that little bit of a voice still alive? Because if it is, then there's hope for you. But if that voice is gone, then there's nothing left in you. There's nothing left making da'wah to. So it's not only that my message is convincing, and my message has good reason. What part of the da'wah is, what is the goodness that is inside of you that is clicking with the message that I'm giving you? There has to be something inside of you that the two lights will come together, nurun ala nur. So, فَقُلْ هَلَّكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّى. Finally, inshallah ta'ala, as far as this word, the هَلَّكَ إِلَىٰ, it's a very powerful expression in Arabic, in that it illustrates not just the presence of goodness, but one's desire to bring out that goodness. One's desire to bring out that goodness. So Musa is asking Fir'aun, he's not questioning that there's a goodness because Allah put goodness inside of every human being. They deny that goodness, that's a separate story. He's saying, do you have any desire left in you to let that goodness in you flourish? This is basically the last resort. I've given you all the da'wah I could, and you've rebelled beyond all reason, but there still might be hope for you if you will let your own conscience be the better judge of the truth. So inshallah ta'ala, with this we take a break. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم هل أتاك حديث موسى إذ ناداه ربه بالوادي المقدس طوى اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى فقل هل لك إلى أن تزكى وأهديك إلى ربك فتخشى فأراه الآية الكبرى فكذب وعصى ثم أدبر يسعى فحشر فنادى فقال أنا ربكم الأعلى فأخذه الله نكال الآخرة والأولى إن في ذلك لعبرة لمن يخشى
رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ثم أما بعد. The ayat I just recited, I recited that selection on purpose, even though we've done some of them already, just to highlight again the rhyme scheme of the ending phonetics. موسى طوى طغى تزكى تخشى الكبرى. Notice the ayah at the end of all of them, right? That even phonetically illustrates that they're part of the same paragraph. It's the same discussion continuing, it's connected somehow. When we go beyond them, there'll be another series of syllables at the ends of ayat. That'll illustrate that that's another grouping of ayat together, that they go together. That's actually a formulation of paragraphs. This is a component of Quran's discourse, the organization of Quranic discourse, that's very difficult to communicate in translation. This component of it, okay? Anyhow, so we were in the midst of the discourse where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى? Didn't the discourse, or didn't the news of Musa, as though it's all new again, come to you already? When his Lord called on to him in the valley of At-Tuwa, and he told him, اِذْهَبْ إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنِ إِنَّهُ طَغَى. Now notice, you know, in other places in the Quran, you're going to find a lot more detail about what happened when he went to At-Tuwa. You'll even find detail on how he got there, when he saw the fire, and you know he's going to go there perhaps to get directions, etc. So why no details here? Why so short here? See, the thing is, in the Quran, the purpose is not telling the story. That's not the purpose. The story is, only the part of the story is cited. Only that part which fits in with the discourse that precedes, and the discourse that will follow. So the stories are repeated. Musa alayhi salam is mentioned over 70 different places in the Quran. Why? Not because we don't know the story one time you've heard it. The point is only to cite that component of his legacy that will be relevant to the discussion at hand, to the surah at hand, to the discourse at hand. And that's what's happening here. So none of the details that are irrelevant to this discussion are mentioned. Only the things that particularly have to do with this discussion are mentioned. This is part of the brevity of speech in the Qur'an. This is also part of the meticulous organization of ideas in the Qur'an's discourse. Anyhow. So, فَقُلْ هَلْ لَكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّى. This is the ayah we left off on. Then say to him, when you go to him, as a result of his rebellion, say to him, fa again, sababiyya,
Also, it's called fa'at-ta'qib, which connects the two things together. Should I give you, do you not see in yourself any inclination, any bit of inclination that you may want to purify yourself, cleanse yourself of your flaws? وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَىٰ. And do you not see in yourself any inclination whatsoever that I may guide you? It's connected. And how do I know it's not a separate sentence altogether? You see the fatha on ahdiya, that fatha ahdiya. Normally it's ahdi, that's a marfu' state. It's in grammar it's called. That ahdiya means it's mansub because of an in the previous ayah, an tazakka. There's one thing I forgot to mention about the previous word that's really important to note. You see the word tazakka in Arabic? And by the way, you guys normally should have a mushaf in front of you so you can follow along, okay? Anyway, tazakka originally is tatazakka. It's tatazakka. For brevity, you can take two ta's out and make it one. Like Allah says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Actually, you can also say, وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا. You can have two ta's there. Originally, there are two ta's there. Similarly, there are two ta's here, tatazakka, but the brief version of it is tazakka. And actually, even though grammatically, it means the same thing. You know, عندما أقول تَتَزَكَّى أَوْ تَزَكَّى, it means the same thing. But in the Qur'an, it means two different things. The Qur'an's language is so sensitive that even words that are dissimilar, we cannot pass them off as, oh, it means the same as تَتَزَكَّى. It's actually separate. For example, in the Qur'an, you will find يَتَدَبَّرُونَ يَتَدَبَّرُونَ, multiple syllables. يَتَدَان. Then you'll find لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. There's idgham, there's fusion of the syllables. You'll find يَتَذَكَّرُونَ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. Then you'll find يَذَّكَّرُونَ. Fusion. So there's, to make the matter simple, in English you say something like, I saw a demo, right? Or you say, I saw a demonstration. You know, the brief version of the word? In a much more sophisticated form in Arabic, you can actually take a syllable in the beginning of the word and remove it because it's redundant. Now when you keep it, it alludes to a more complete context. And when you take it away, it's a more partial context. In other words, the word tazakka here is, do you find not even a little bit of an inclination to purify even anything of your character? If it's tatazakka, it's more complete. Refine everything about your character. But not a thing about your character do I see that you want to change. You're very happy with the way you are. And the ultimate tughyan that some of the ulama mentioned under this ayah, for example, in Tafsir al-Midraq, we found that that his worst rebellion was that he saw something, nothing wrong in his rebellion. There was no guilt. There was not even an inclination that I'm doing something wrong. And this was Fir'auniyya. This is really the Fir'aunic state of mind. Anyhow, this is being illustrated because the mushrikun are turning into this. The ones that are that Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's talking to them. They're turning into Fir'aun, all of them, because they find in them no inclination to even consider the goodness that they know to be true, that's deep inside of them. وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ. And that I may guide you towards your Lord. Now you see the word hidayah? In the Qur'an it's used in multiple ways. In the Fatiha we find اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. All of you know this by heart. But we don't find اِهْدِنَا إِلَىٰ الصِّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Here you find وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ. There's no إِلَىٰ in Fatiha, and there's a difference. Actually, the closer the literary interpretation of اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ is guide us to and along the straight path. The most common translations we find are guide us to the straight path. That would have been correct and complete if the Arabic was اِهْدِنَا إِلَىٰ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. But there's no إِلَىٰ in the Fatiha. So the meaning, it becomes حَال also, right? And all of the prepositions are understood when you remove a preposition. So the meaning is guide us to and along the straight path. In other words, the path is there. When you say guide to, that means knowledge, by the way. When you use the preposition to, like if I say guide me to the airport, what are you going to give me? You're going to give me a map, or you're going to give me directions, right? You're going to give me knowledge. But when I say guide me to and along, then it's not just knowledge, it's also support. All right, I'll sit in the car with you, I'll come with you, right? Here, Musa alayhi salam is illustrating, وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ. I will guide you to your Lord, meaning let me teach you, let me at least tell you. What this illustrates is he doesn't even want to hear it. He doesn't even want to hear it. Plus, it is only appropriate for Musa alayhi salam to guide someone to, or to give them knowledge of. Because in the end, guiding someone along the path, who's the only one who can do that? That is exclusive to Allah. So it's appropriately used ila. Then, ila rabbik. This is actually a fundamental term in this surah. Rububiyyah, Rabb. I will guide you to your Rabb. Why? You will find a little bit further down, what is Fir'aun going to say? أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَىٰ. I am your supreme Rabb, your Rabb. And it is actually the concept of rububiyyah that's at the heart of belief in the akhirah. And we have to connect these two things together. The key term, you know, in reference to Allah, we don't find the word Allah here. What do we find? We don't say, wa ahdiyaka ila Allahi fatakhsha. Or awla ar-Rahman. We found ar-Rahman in Surah Naba. Here the key word we find is Rabb. The key word here is Rabb. And actually it is a continuation of the end of Naba where we read رَبِّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا الرَّحْمَنِ. Now here that same Rabb is actually showing mercy even to Fir'aun. He's not closing the door on him until he closes the door on himself. وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَىٰ. Then you may find any inclination to fear for yourself. Remember khashya we talked about before. A fear of something magnanimous. A fear of something huge. If I give you knowledge of it and you're able to internalize any of it, you'll realize how insignificant you are, and in comparison how enormous your Lord is, it will put you in a state of khashya. That word is perfectly relevant, specifically for Fir'aun, because he doesn't think of anything grander than who? Himself. So that specific word of fear, the kind of fear that is of something greater than yourself, that's the specific word of fear used, khashya here, not khawf. Not any other kind of fear, that specific kind of fear. فَتَخْشَىٰ. The other thing that's very beautiful, a lesson in this is, وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ. I will guide you, or let me, don't you even find any inclination or any permission in yourself to let me guide you to your Lord, or give you knowledge of the fact of your Lord. And if you had that knowledge, then what would necessarily happen? Fa, as a result, فَسَبَبِيَّ تَخْشَىٰ. As a result, you would be overwhelmed in fear. You will be in fear of something greater than yourself. What we learn from this is, true knowledge leads to what? It leads to fear. True knowledge leads to fear. This is why we find, وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ. The people mature in knowledge, Allah calls them ulul albab, right? The people of pure intellect, in Ali Imran. These are the truly knowledgeable, mature in knowledge. Those same ulul albab, at the end of Ali Imran, they're explained further. You want to learn more about them? لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. And in that passage, you find these people of knowledge, they're afraid. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا. Actually, they're begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَتَوَفَّنَا مَعَ الْأَبْرَارِ لَا تُخْزِنَا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. You know, give us what you promised your messengers. Don't humiliate us on the day of resurrection. They're terrified. That's how the people of knowledge are described. So if you had that knowledge, the first consequence of that knowledge would be, you would be afraid. فَتَخْشَىٰ. فَأَرَاهُ الْآيَةَ الْكُبْرَىٰ. And by the way, again, remember, we are being told of Musa and Fir'aun, Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun, لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ. But what we're really talking about actually is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Quraysh. That's what's really going on. This is a parallel. It's not a story. There are parallels to this situation from that situation. فَأَرَاهُ الْآيَةَ الْكُبْرَىٰ. Then, in order to make him, you know, find that goodness inside of him, a little bit of help from the outside, Allah says, then he showed him, meaning Musa alayhi salam showed him, al-ayat al-kubra, the ultimate sign. The ultimate sign, the huge. Kubra is the feminine equivalent of akbar. You know, we say Allahu akbar. The feminine of akbar in Arabic is kubra. Like ahsan is husna. Okay? And these are from the superlative. Afdal al-tafdil, it's called in Arabic. The superlative adjective. So the ultimate sign. Now we know Musa alayhi salam was given many signs. But we know that Fir'aun was terrified of all the signs, most of the staff turning into a snake. How do we know he was terrified of that most? Because when he hired those magicians and he sent out his recruiters, what did they train to compete with? The hand? They didn't compete with the light lit hand. They didn't compete with the locust or the nine signs. When they came to compete, what did they throw? حِبَالُهُمْ وَعَصِيُّهُمْ. They threw their ropes and their rods to simulate or to compete with that which terrified him the most. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, so he showed him the ultimate sign, the greatest sign. And then as a result, by the way, for Fir'aun, the greatest sign was the staff turning into a snake. But the parallel again is in Muhammad's time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the Quraysh. What's the sign that he's showing them? It is Quran itself. That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam showed the Quraysh over the course of years the miraculous eloquence, the power, the mesmerizing power of this Quran, the relentless power of this Quran. That's the ayatul kubra for them. Al-kitab, you know, al-akbar, the greatest book. So now, as a result, even after seeing that miracle, because there was nothing inside of him that wanted to return to good, what did he do instead? فَكَذَّبَ وَعَصَى. Then the two things Allah mentions in this ayah. فَكَذَّبَ, then as a result, he did takdeeb. Now usually, كَذَّبَ, there's usually a maf'ul bihi, there's an object. فَكَذَّبَ بِمُوسَى فَكَذَّبَ بِالْآيَةِ. There's no B, there's no object mentioned. All that's mentioned is, he lied against. Now when you say he lied against, you're expecting lied against who? Lied against the sign, lied against Musa, lied against his whole conscience. When you want to say he lied against all of those things, you leave out the object. So all of them are implied as the object. That's a tool in Arabic. So فَكَذَّبَ, he lied against Musa alayhi salam, propagated against Musa alayhi salam. He lied against the sign that Musa alayhi salam showed him, calling the sign magic, calling it a lie, calling it trickery. Then he lied against his own conscience, which deep inside was telling him that that's the truth. So all of that is included by Allah not mentioning a maf'ul bihi with abba, kadhaba bi, something. So kadhaba, that's the first thing. By the way, this is the same thing that the Quraysh are doing. When they see the ultimate sign, their response, in those of them that have any inkling of truth in them, that doesn't lead them to this. But the ones that find nothing in them of goodness, it results them not only to lying to themselves, or lying against the book that it's not the truth, they actually propagate lies against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those who propagate lies against the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what we learn from this from default is they have no inkling of goodness in them. Those who propagate lies against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa'asa. And then, in addition, he did isyan, asa. That's the verb that's used. Now asa means to disobey. There are three kinds of disobedience talked about in the Quran. We should know about them. The word asa is to also to refuse or to disobey. But more specifically, it is to disobey or to refuse to do something that you know to be good. That's when isyan is used. When you know it's good, when you know it's not a bad thing, and you still refuse, that's when the word isyan is used. This is perfectly appropriate here specifically because we already talked about him not having even the slightest inclination inside of him. فَقُلْ هَلَّكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّى. Right? There's not even a little bit of an inclination to purify any bit of himself. No goodness left. So when he sees something good, he disobeys, he refuses to accept it. Another kind of disobedience that's mentioned in the Quran is fisq, corruption. The commonly translated corruption. Literally means to abandon a path that was good to begin with. So someone who has fisq is someone who was good and then went the wrong way. Or who walked the good path and then abandoned it. And the one who keeps abandoning it, in fiqh also we call him a fasiq. He keeps disobeying Allah. He keeps going the wrong way despite knowing the right way. Then another kind of wrongdoing or disobedience is called fujur, from fajara. And it literally means to tear something wide open. This is the kind of fasiq who doesn't only disobey but is proud of his disobedience and is open about his disobedience and disobeys in the worst kind of ways. So this is a fajr. You know the complaint of Nuh alayhi salam, وَلَنْ يَلِدُوا إِلَّا فَاجِرًا كَفَّارًا. Right? They will give birth to no one except fajr. They will be, you know, audacious, shameless in the way they do sins. And they will be relentless in their disbelief. So fajr, that's the third kind. Asa specifically, the one who refuses to do something they know to be good. This is isyan. Now, فَكَذَّبَ وَعَصَى. Now, this is what Fir'aun did. But in the context of this surah, what is the takdeeb? What are you lying? What are the kuffar lying against? You see, their takdeeb was manifest when they said, "Inna la marduduna fil hafira." In this surah, are we going to be returned to the old state again? Back to the old way? All back to normal? Is that what's going to happen? Then they lied again. "Aida kunna idhaman nakhira." We're going to be reduced to decayed bones. Then they did takdeeb again. They lied again when they said, "Tilka idhan karratun khasira." Oh, that's going to be a really terrible kind of attack on us and a return. How horrible is that going to be? And they were being sarcastic when they said these things. This is their takdeeb. This is their takdeeb. Now Allah says, tells us more about Fir'aun, and through him tells us more about the state of the Quraysh. ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى. Then he turned away. What this means is he's pacing back and forth. Sa'i in Arabic isn't really to run. It is a state faster than walking, but slower than running. To pace. You know how we say pace? To quickly pace? So you can, what the image that's been illustrated is, Fir'aun is up in his castle somewhere, the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam has awed and completely wowed even his ministers, and it's spreading far and wide, and the message can't be stopped. The more he tries to put it down, the worse it gets. If you study the dialogue between Musa and Fir'aun, you find the more Fir'aun tries to put it down, the more mesmerizing Musa alayhi salam becomes for the audience. And so the situation goes from bad to worse to worse to worse for Fir'aun. His propaganda to shut this thing down is not working. So what's he doing? He's sitting up in his cabinet, up in his office, pacing back and forth. What this illustrates is he's restless. He's restless. And he's trying to figure out what to do next. And you know we talked about the word tadbir before? فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا تَدْبِيرٍ. This is idbar. Idbar. And idbar is actually lesser than tadbir. It's to try to plan something, but try to put it together too quickly, so quickly you haven't given it enough thought. Had you given it enough thought, what would it have been? Tadbir. That would have been tadbir. So this is just him turning back and forth, trying to come up with something. And we know he's a victim of this because you know when Musa alayhi salam first comes to him, he calls him majnoon. He calls him crazy, he calls him possessed. A couple of seconds later, he calls him sahir, magician. Then a couple of seconds later, he says, يُرِيدُ أَن يُخْرِجَكُم مِّنْ أَرْضِكُمْ. He wants to expel you from your land. Well, the crazy thing didn't work, people are still listening. Let's call him a magician. Well, the magician thing's not working either, so let's just try to scare people, tell him he's a threat to homeland security, he's going to get you kicked out of your land. That's the reason you should fear him, right? And then when none of this worked, oh, إِنَّهُ لَكَبِيرُكُمْ الَّذِي عَلَّمَكُمُ السِّحْرَ. He's the biggest of you guys who taught you magic. One lie after another. But he's kind of trying to improvise because he's running out of things to dismantle the message of the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam. So ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى. Then Allah illustrates to us the desperation that he had. فَحَشَرَ. You know, jama'a in Arabic is to gather. Hashara is also to gather, in translation at least. But the difference between hashara and jama'a is hashara is to herd. Like you do it for animals. Okay? And on the Day of Judgment, Allah says, وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. Wild animals are going to be herded together. Typically when you think of being herded, you think of cows and sheep. That's what you can herd. So he herded people together like animals. Why? Because the people are in their homes, they're listening to the message, they're discussing it, they're thinking about it. Now he needs to bring them all together, force them all together, stand in front of them, and then reiterate the beliefs they're supposed to have, the official policy of the state, the official religion of the country. Right? So فَحَشَرَ. Then he gathered them forcefully, but we learned this from the word hashara. Then he called out to them. What did he call out to them? فَقَالَ. He made a call. فَقَالَ. As he said, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. I am your supreme lord. Now the thing is, this was already known. The claim that he is the Rabb, supposedly, of the land, was something already known. This was something that the soldiers would reiterate. But the fact that the da'wah was getting so strong that he felt the need to gather people and then remind them that he is their Lord, but not just their Lord, أَنَا رَبُّكُمْ. Not just that, he said, رَبُّكُمْ الْأَعْلَى. I am your supreme Lord. Now, supremacy illustrates there's somebody else claiming to be a Lord, and now it seems to be that I'm in competition with that Lord. I'm the higher one. أَنَا رَبُّكُمْ الْأَعْلَى. He felt the desperate need to say this to his people. Why? Because as you read in other places, Musa alayhi salam comes to him, the first thing Musa says to him, إِنَّا رَسُولُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, the Lord of the worlds. He tries to wash it off. He says, Musa says, وَوَهَبَ لِي رَبِّي حُكْمًا, my Lord granted me firmness and made me from the messengers. Mentions the Lord again, his Lord, the Lord of the worlds. Then comes back again, he says, مَا رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Musa says, رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضُ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا. Again he says, the Lord of the heavens, Rabb of the heavens and the earth and whatever lies in between. Then he tries to distract him again. Musa doesn't get off course. He says again, رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا, the Lord of the East and the West, whatever's in between them. Then Fir'aun tries to dismantle that, tries to come up with something else. Musa alayhi salam comes back again and says, رَبُّكُمْ وَرَبُّ أَبَائِكُمُ الْأَوَّلِينَ, your Lord and the Lord of your earliest forefathers. Rab. Musa alayhi salam is not letting go of the fact that you need to be introduced to the real Rabb, right? So now he's threatened because this other Rabb is now being believed in and people are getting impressed with the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam. So he has to come out and say, I am your supreme Rabb. Now this was his shirk. The shirk of the Quraysh was allegiance to their tradition. It wasn't the same exact thing as Fir'aun, but the net result is the same. The net result is your either it's your false gods, that's your god, your tradition is your god, that you can't show, you can't leave or abandon their allegiance. Or Fir'aun himself, he claims to be the God himself, he claims to be the Rabb himself. Anyway, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. This is his ultimate crime. One passage, at least we should go through, that illustrates this nida of Fir'aun. وَنَادَى فِرْعَوْنُ فِي قَوْمِهِ. It's a different surah we find. And Fir'aun made a call into his nation. قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ أَلَيْسَ لِي مُلْكُ مِصْرِ. He called to his nation saying, my nation, isn't it true that I have the dominion, the sovereignty, the kingship of Egypt at my disposal? وَهَذِهِ الْأَنْهَارُ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِي. And these rivers, they flow at my feet. They flow underneath me. أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ And why don't you see? Now, the fact that he had to say, why don't you see, illustrates that they're seeing something else. It's something else that they see that they're impressed with. أَمْ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ هَذَا الَّذِي هُوَ مُهِينٌ Am I not better than this humiliated one, this lower race? And then he says, وَلَا يَكَادُ يُبِينَ And sometimes he can't even speak clearly. He can't even articulate himself, referring to the stutter of Musa alayhi salam. So now, this dialogue of Fir'aun, actually, you would think it's an illustration of his arrogance and his power. But at the same time, actually, it's an illustration of his weakness. It's actually an illustration that ideologically, what he has to say has become hollow, that he has to start doing this kind of propaganda in public. He never felt the need to go and talk to the people and sway them to his side. Anybody looks him in the eye, he can just kill him. That was the kind of fear that was raging in the hearts of the people. But when the da'wah spread, the fear is subsiding. And now there's knowledge of a real Lord. And Musa alayhi salam as an alternative form of leadership. So there's a political shift in the land. And he needs to come and give a public address, a national inaugural address, and remind the people, hey, look at me. I'm still the king here. These rivers are still at my feet. SubhanAllah. So this is, فَحَشَرَ فَنَادَ فَقَالَ أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى Then Allah reminds the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَأَخَذَهُ اللَّهُ نَكَالَ الْآخِرَةِ وَالْأُولَى Then Allah took him, seized him, and made nakal out of him. Now nakal actually in Arabic is used for an anklet or a bracelet that in ancient prisons was tied to a wall, you know, the chain and then an anklet, so you can't move. It was also used for chains that prisoners have together, so when the guard moves them, they all are forced to move. They can't stay in one place. So it's an anklet that either restricts your movement or forces your movement where your movement isn't on your own. Right, this is nakal. And this was used as a means to show others when they would come or pass by, they would see these prisoners. So they would be deterred that we better not break the law, otherwise we're going to end up like this. So the nakal was a means of injecting fear into a population. This was how it was done. Okay, and also before somebody was executed, they were put in nakal. They were put in these chains. So this was a means of actually terrifying the masses of people to not stand up against the status quo. This was a means by which it was done. Allah says that He took Fir'aun and He made a nakal out of him. Now that's interestingly ironic because He made it basically a deterrent out of him. Don't be like him because he's the worst kind of example for al-akhirati wal-ula. And so he is a worst kind of example for the last of people to walk this earth and the earliest. Also means a worst case in terms of the hereafter and also in this life. But the thing is, if you look at Fir'aun's discourse and his anger, when he saw people believe, you know what he said to them? He said, I'm going to make an example out of you. I'm going to cut your hands and your feet from opposite sides. He was the one who was saying, I'm going to make an example out of you. Here Allah says, Allah took him and made an example out of him for even the last ones to come. So by this, Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying to the Quraysh who are skeptical and loosely talking about the hereafter, look, take the warning. People much more powerful before you have been dealt with already. And by this very thing, the Messenger is being told, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, don't worry about it. Even if they disbelieve, Allah has dealt with far worse already. Allah is on your side, Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. You just keep doing what you're doing. Two things at the same time. Issuing a deadly threat to the kafir, the one denying the hereafter, and issuing a consolation and a support to the Messenger, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى In all of that, there is ibrah. Ibrah is a very interesting word in Arabic. You know, commonly it's translated as a lesson and a warning. But ibrah comes from ubur, to cross water. Like if you want to cross a river, right? This is ubur. Abar al-Nahr, for example, or Abru al-Nahr is used, it's the place, like a dock on the river, where the ship goes and goes straight across the water. That's Abru al-Nahr. Abar al-Ayn, or Abarat al-Ayn is used in Arabic when you shed a tear. Meaning that the tear has crossed the lines of your eye and it's come out. Right? Now, this is how the word ibrah is used. So if, when you say for about a person, abara, it means he is so sad he's brought to a point of tears. By using inna fi dhalika la ibra, in the account, especially in that, meaning especially in the account of Fir'aun and Musa alayhi salam, in that account, especially in it, there is no doubt about it, there is enough reason for one to shed tears out of sadness if they realize the state of their affairs. There's enough for that. And then the crossing water analogy, how that applies here is, there's enough of a clue in that for you to cross the waters from falsehood into now truth. لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى But again, there's a condition. The only people who will be able to cross this, the only people who feel sadness and realize that they've been on the wrong side of things, are people who have what in them? Fear. لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. Who has the ability to feel fear still. They have some fear of consequence, of something larger than themselves. Now, after this discourse, there were multiple paragraphs in this surah. I want you to be aware of the division of discussions. The first one was the passage, وَالنَّازِعَات. That was the first passage. The second passage, then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts speaking about the day of judgment. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةِ and so forth. Okay, that was the next. Then there was the هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَىٰ إِذْ نَادَ رَبُّهُ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ. The discourse of Musa alayhi salam. That was the third paragraph, you could say. Now the fourth paragraph. And its style is also different. أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءُ بَنَاهَا رَفَعَ سَمْكَهَا فَسَوَّاهَا. You hear something? Right? وَأَغْطَشَ لَيْلَهَا وَأَخْرَجَ ضُحَاهَا. You see the rhyme scheme returning? Because it's a new passage. It's a new discourse. And even from when we study the subject matter, we'll appreciate that. Here Allah says, are you more severe a construction, a creation? Are you more powerful or more difficult? Shadid also is used in the sense of difficulty. In other words, are you more difficult or severe or intense in terms of being created, or is the sky? Are you tougher to build or the sky? أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ. When you go to Surah Naba, we found the earth first and the sky second. أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. And then afterwards, وَبَنَيْنَا فَوْقَكُمْ سَبْعًا شِدَادًا. There was the earth and then the sky. But we said there's a reversal from Surah Naba and Surah An-Nazi'at. So now the reverse is used. Allah Azza wa Jalla speaks of the sky, and then what's He going to speak of? The earth. He's going to reverse the sequence. Okay. So He says, are you more intense in construction of the sky? Banaha, He built it. Now, but bina is to build something where one piece of it meshes into the other. Like a building is called bina because one brick meshes into the other, or one wall meshes into the other. So Allah is illustrating that the sky is a seamless construction where one thing falls into the next. Sama also comes from the words, the original seen, meme, and wow, which actually means whatever lies above you. So don't just think of sama in Arabic as the sky, is everything above. The body, the planets, the stars, the moons, the galaxies, all of it is considered sama. Inshallah, when we get to the passages where we compare the phrase samawat in the Quran with sama, we'll see that difference more clearly. But for now, just know, sama is everything above. Everything above, not just the sky. So is that which is above tougher to create? These galaxies and universes Allah Azza wa Jalla created, is that tougher, or your creation, your, you know, puny creation? He constructed that. He put that together seamlessly. رَفَعَ سَمْكَهَا. He elevated its roof. Samk is actually the top of something. For example, Sanamun Samik is actually used, you know, for the higher, you know, the hoofs of a camel, right? The humps of a camel, the higher one is Samik, right? So the heart, the highest part of it. Allah says he elevated the highest part of the sky. Now the thing is, in construction, you could tell the building is really tall by looking at the highest point of it. Allah Azza wa Jalla says He elevated the canopy or the roof of the sky to the point where we can't even see it. That's how intense this construction of the sky is. In another place, هَلْ تَرَى مِنْ فُطُورٍ. Do you see any crack, any end to it even? So for us, it's an endless thing, and Allah illustrates how endless it is for us by saying He's the one who elevated its roof. رَفَعَ سَمْكَهَا فَسَوَّهَا. And then He balanced it, straightened it out, leveled it to perfection. Taswiya actually means all of these things, to balance, to level, to actually mold to perfection. وَأَغْطَشَ لَيْلَهَا. This is actually one of my points of curiosity in the Qur'an. Allah Azza wa Jal speaks about the night in many ways. Many different words are used for the darkness of the night. Each one of them has their own connotation. Many of them are concentrated in juz'amma. Many of them are put together in juz'amma. Here we have, for example, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا عَصْعَصْ. As'as is referred to when the night, the chokehold of the night, as soon as it starts taking over. Okay? The chokehold of the night, as soon as it starts taking over, and also when the chokehold of the night starts leaving, and the morning gets a chance to breathe. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا تَنَفَّسْ. When the morning gets a chance to breathe, take a breath. غَسَقَ وَاللَّيْلِ وَمَا غَسَقَ, for example. وَاللَّيْلِ وَمَا غَسَقَ. This is the dark of the night settling in when the blue of the night is completely gone. There's only black left. That's ghasaq. Then irtash, which is what's used here, wa aghtash alaylaha. This is the darkness of the night, highlighting the difficulty with which one can see. Things become blurry. Things become confused with one another. You can't see if it's two people or one person. right? You can't see if it's a truck or a motorcycle or two motorcycles. You can't tell. So this is when vision becomes blurry. That's what's illustrated in أغطش ليلها. He made the night exceptionally dark, hardened it for it to be hard for you to see in it. وأخرج ضحاها, and he brought out of it that very dark night where you couldn't see anything. ضحا. ضحا is the time of the morning that's the brightest, when it's clearest and easiest to see. So Allah contrasts two things. He made the night so dark you couldn't tell truth from falsehood, figuratively speaking. And then he brought a day where there's absolute clarity, one thing from the other. There's no confusion left. This is actually in between the lines, a reference to Revelation. There was night so bad where you were picking God, this God versus that God, this idol versus that idol. It was all confusing to you people. What's going to happen after we die? Oh, we're not going to come back. Yeah, we will come back. We'll all go to heaven. None of us will go to heaven. There is no heaven. All this confusion. It was like the night. And now, out of that night, he has brought out this clear day. وَأَخْرَجَ بُحَاهَا. He has brought out the clearest of that day. وَالْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ دَحَاهَا. And the earth thereafter, he made it smooth in its surface. Now, daha is an interesting word. Some people have tried to give a parallel from the point of view of Islam and science in this ayah. I'm not a big fan personally of Islam and science yet. I'm not convinced entirely. Because I think we have to be true to the language and we shouldn't bend the meaning to fit science in it. If it's there, it's there, fine. But we shouldn't twist the meanings and abandon the additional classical meanings and say, it means this, and now the scientific phenomenon clicks with the ayah. Anyway, I will tell you what the classical meaning is. The word daha, actually, it's used, dahwa was used for the egg of an ostrich. So dahwa was used for the egg of an ostrich. Udhiyya, actually, was used for the place where the ostrich lays its egg. So some have used that to say, Wallahu a'lam, that because there's an implication of something oval or round, and Allah speaks about the earth and how He made it daha, He made it oval or round in shape. That's what the implication some have used. Allahu a'lam, the truth in it. Anyhow, what we do know in the classical sense, daha yadhu dahwun, means to smoothen and to spread out. So what Allah is illustrating here is, after the earth and the sky and its magnificent creation, and how Allah made the sky a means of delivering the darkest night where you can't see, and also the brightest morning when you can see everything, also notice the powerful creation of the earth and how widely it spread. وَالْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ دَحَاهَا. And perhaps this is also a reminder to the kafir who's been listening to the surah, where Allah Azza wa Jal said, فَإِذَا هُمْ بِالسَّاهِرَةِ. They're going to end up in that flat, clear land. Allah said, look, He made the land clear. So when you see clear land, you should remember that land where you're going to be landing eventually anyway. أَخْرَجَ مِنْهَا مَاءَهَا وَمَرْعَاهَا. He drew out from it its water. That's the easy word. Mar'a is a little bit of a difficult word here. Mar'a is actually ism dharf makan. It's a noun used to allude to a place, a space. Ra'i is used for pasturing, right? And it's also used for pasture land, like grazing land, like fields and fields of farm and grass and stuff, where you grow produce for animals, for your cattle, and also for yourself. So Allah says, basically, first He made the earth flat and smooth and expanded. Then He drew from it water, and also these pasture lands, these places where you can pasture, and these times where you can pasture. وَالْجِبَالَ أَرْسَاهَا, and He created the mountains, and He drew out mountains, and أَرْسَاهَا, إِرْسَا in Arabic actually means to draw, to put an anchor down on a large ship. That is إِرْسَا. So He says He put mountains like they are anchored into the ground, that they're anchored deep into the ground. The idea being, you can't just pluck them out and move them. They're not like any other building that you can demolish and get up, but they're fixed constructions that are very difficult, are very tough in their construction. Also, irsa was used for pegging, to peg something into the ground. This word actually will come up again in the surah. This is an interesting correlation of terms from beginning to end. Here Allah says, مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِأَنْعَامِكُمْ. So after speaking a little bit about the earth, a little bit about the sky, then a little about the earth, and at the end of it Allah says, all of this, مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ. This is provisions for you to use. مَتَاعًا. تَمَتُّعْ actually means to use and enjoy. But mata' alone is just to use. In the ancient Arabic, mata' was used, for example, for the scrub that you use to wash your dishes with. It's not something you enjoy, but it's definitely something you use, right? So dunya has been defined here as something to use, but not necessarily to enjoy. And that's the word is highly appropriate, because the real problem of the one who denies akhirah is they're too addicted to enjoying dunya. Allah wants you to use dunya, but not necessarily to indulge yourself in its enjoyment. There's a higher purpose for which you were created. مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِأَنْعَامِكُمْ. provisions for you, these things to use for yourselves, these produce to use for yourselves, and also for your cattle. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. This is the final passage of this surah. Then, when inshallah, I'll take 10 more minutes. Is that okay? Inshallah, we'll try to wrap up as much as we can. If we can't finish, Allahu A'lam, then we'll go to the next evening, inshallah, or next Wednesday. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. Then finally, when جاءت, first of all, those of you that speak a little bit of Arabic, أتت and جاءت both mean came, but one of them has more severity. جاء is more severe than أتى. جاء is used for larger, bigger things, and أتى is easy arrival. جاء is grand arrival. So this is grand already because of the use of the word جاء. If that means all of a sudden here, then when all of a sudden, what comes? What makes this grand entrance all of a sudden? الطامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. طم in Arabic is used for something to be completely full. And طم النهر, for example, طم البئر actually, is when a guy takes dirt and fills up the well all the way, it's completely full of dirt. That's طم. طم is a calamity that is so full and so overwhelming from every direction, there's no escape from it. It's an overwhelming calamity, completely full of trouble any direction you turn to. So when this طامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى, the ultimate, the greatest, most complete calamity, all of a sudden arrives, makes its grand entrance, then on that day, يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى. What's interesting here are a few words. First thing, يَتَذَكَّرُ. We said there's idgham, right? There's, you can use abbreviated words like يَذَّكَّرُ, يَوْمَ يَذَّكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ, but Allah says يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ, which means he will remember thoroughly everything. He will stop at every last memory and reflect, man, I messed up here, I messed up here, I messed up here. The complete recollection of everything you did is captured in the word yatadhakkar. The day on which the human being will thoroughly remember every last thing that he worked towards, everything that he rushed towards. You remember we found Fir'aun, ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى, right? In the very same surah, he would turn around and rush and pace. Allah says that everything that the human being used to rush towards, to pace towards. So it's connecting that term to here. He was pacing towards keeping his rule. Other human beings pace towards keeping their dunya, their wealth, to walk away from the religion and to pursue a life of pleasure. These are the things he will remember. But you know, the things that, the audacity of the kafir that's mentioned earlier on in the surah, they say things. يَقُولُونَ قَالُوا. Their crime in this surah, if you look at the kuffar that are mentioned in the surah, is their speech. They're skeptical of the hereafter. But Allah is seeing through their speech and saying, actually, this speech is a result of the things you want to run towards. That's why you're talking like this. So then you will remember not just the speech, but the motives for the speech, the sa'i that was behind this speech, the efforts that you used to make. You'll find in the Qur'an, for example, وَلَقَدْ صَرَّفْنَا فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لِيَذَّكَّرُوا. We have manipulated the message and presented it in varying ways in this Qur'an, so they may remember at least a little bit. لِيَذَّكَّرُوا. See, Allah didn't say لِيَتَذَكَّرُوا. So they may remember the whole thing. At least they'll get some reminder from it. At some point they will remember. At least they'll get something out of it. لِيَذَّكَّرُوا. وَبُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِمَنْ يَرَى. And the hellfire will be brought forward. بُرِّزَ or بَرَّزَ, you know, تَبْرِيز actually, is used to pull something out and put it in front of someone. بُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ, hellfire will be brought out and put in front of someone. In front of who? لِمَنْ يَرَى. Put in front of the one who wishes to see, who wants to see. You know why this is so powerful? Because if you look at the complaints of the skeptics, they said, oh, I can't visualize when bones are going to be resurrected again, when we're going to be brought back to our original state. And now, you want to see? You know what? We'll show you eventually. وَبُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِمَنْ يَرَى. And the entire jahim, jahama actually is a very powerful word in Arabic. Jahama is used when a lion is staring at you with hungry eyes. That's the word jahama. And it's one of the names of the hellfire. It's also used when a blaze is so intense it looks almost like it's staring at you. Like it's about to pounce on you. That's one of the names of the hellfire. So this enraged hellfire, بُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ, will be brought forward for anyone to look at, meaning they'll have to look at the rage of it. And it's looking at them with rage, and they're looking at it with rage. So they're looking with yara, the hellfire is looking with the word jahim, subhanAllah. فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى. Then as for the one who still rebelled, meaning in this dunya, who resorted to rebellion, The word taga is really interesting here because what was the message of Fir'aun? What message of Musa alayhi salam to Fir'aun? Why was he sent? اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى. He had rebelled. Now the parallel is being brought to life. That wasn't just a story. As far as you guys are concerned, anyone, not just Fir'aun, فَأَمَّا مَنْ, whoever engages in rebellion, وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, and gave preference. آثَرَ, like it's used in a good way too, يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, right? They give preference to others, even at the expense of their own selves. Here Allah says, وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. This person gave preference to worldly life, to closer life, to inferior life. So the real rebellion, the source of rebellion has been mentioned here, is preferring worldly life, is giving preference to worldly life. It has nothing even to do with disbelieving in the Akhirah. That's not even the problem. The problem is preference. You gave preference, you gave more weight to this, you gave more priority to this. That's the real rebellion that's mentioned, subhanAllah. فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Then that Jahim that was brought out, that is the place of, that is going to be it, in fact, alone will be al-ma'wa. Al-ma'wa comes from iwa in Arabic, which is to find some place to seek refuge and hide from danger. But wait a second, we just said Jahim is this blazing fire like a roaring lion, staring at you with the eyes and the gawk of death. And Allah says that Jahim will be your place to find refuge. This is Allah's sarcasm. You see, they began with sarcasm. تِلْكَ إِذَنْ كَرَّةُ الْخَاسِرَةُ. Right? They spoke like this about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Akhirah. Now Allah is speaking to them with sarcasm. You want to find refuge? That's going to be your refuge. That blazing, that enraged flame. May Allah protect us from the hellfire. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. And as for the one who feared standing before their Lord. The one who had fear of standing before their Lord. Remind yourself, Musa alayhi salam was giving an offer to Fir'aun. وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَى. I'll guide you to your Lord. You'll get some knowledge. You'll gain some fear. But the believer has an even stronger fear, as though of a manifest thing. And that manifest fear is captured in the word khawf. فَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ. As for the one who feared even standing in front of their Lord. He didn't fear their Lord. Feared the standing itself. مَقَام is ظَرْف, زَمَان and مَكَان. Which means we fear that place, and we fear that time. That time where we have to stand in front of our Lord. And as a result of that sphere of consequence, وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى, he prevented the nafs. By the way, what's beautiful here is Allah didn't say وَنَهَا نَفْسَهُ. He prevented his own self, his self, himself. He didn't say that. He said النَّفْس. It's almost as though Allah wants you to make a conflict within yourself, against yourself, as though you're fighting somebody else. It's like there's another person inside you that is calling to the hellfire. إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. Right? There's a nafs inside you commanding you to evil. And Allah wants you to see that nafs as an enemy. So He doesn't even give it possessive, نَفْسَهُ. That He forbidded His own self. Because you know when you say, I forbade myself, you're talking about yourself. Allah wants you to think of it as an external entity inside you that He wants you to fight. نَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. He fought that nafs that was inside of him, but not really him. Don't think that that's you. That's a challenge to you, inside of you, that you have to defeat. عَنِ الْهَوَى, from vain, pathetic desire, from empty desire, that seems so powerful at the moment, but when it subsides, there's nothing there. That's hawa. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Then for such person, the paradise is his place of finding refuge. That's his place of getting safety from danger. SubhanAllah, two ma'wa mentioned. The hellfire and then the paradise. May Allah make us of the people of paradise. Please keep in mind, this surah is not about belief and disbelief in the hereafter. There are other passages that deal with that. This surah is about preference of the hereafter versus preference of dunya, which is the root cause of someone who claims to disbelieve in the hereafter. It's attacking the root of the problem. And this root problem can be a disease for the Muslim too. The Muslim that falls into dunya and forgets the Akhirah, and they don't give it preference, even though they claim to believe in it. Or when it's talked about, they talk about it casually. Oh, come on, Allah is merciful. Relax already. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Why do you have to go to Maliki Yawmiddin? Right? Just keep it at Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Anyhow, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ. Actually, this is the final passage. They ask you about the hour. We'll be done very quickly, inshallah. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ. They ask you about the hour. أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا. When is it going to be pegged? You know, وَالْجِبَالَ أَرْسَاهَا. Same root, same word. Now they're speaking sarcastically. They're saying, we see the mountainous pegs, that's secure. But this idea of the hour approaching and everything falling apart, when is this idea going to really come and situate itself, peg itself and anchor itself? Ayyana mursaha. Fima anta min dhikraha. Allah puts this to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah quotes their audacity and then turns to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says, Fima anta min dhikraha, which means, what place do you have? In what capacity are you going to make mention of the hour? Now, think about this question carefully. In what capacity are you to make mention of the hour? Now, is the Messenger supposed to talk about the hour? Absolutely. But in a particular capacity. Not in the capacity of when is it, what date, what time of the day. Not in that capacity. In the capacity that it's coming, get ready for it. That's his capacity. So, فِيمَا أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَهَا. Allah poses the question to the Messenger, reminding him and them, in what capacity are you to be speaking about it? And then Allah says, who has the full knowledge of it? إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَا. Only to your Lord. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ is اختصاص, because it's taqdeem of it, it's earlier. So only to your Lord will the final and complete knowledge of it be returned. It is not in possession of anyone else. Muntaha comes from intiha, which is the conclusion of something. This also implies that only to your Lord is the possession, the ownership of the very beginning of the events of Akhirah to the very end of the events of Akhirah. All of this is in complete possession of your Lord. Now remember, the previous statement was فِيمَا أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَهَا. In what capacity are you going to make mention of it? Now Allah specifies what capacity is the Messenger's capacity to speak about the hereafter. He says, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنْذِرْ مَنْ يَخْشَهَا. You are nothing more than a warner to the one who will actually gain some fear out of this. The recurring themes in this surah, خَشْيَة, right? وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَى, right? لِمَنْ يَخْشَى إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. Again, then here again, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنْذِرُ مَنْ يَخْشَاهَا. Who will have fear of a larger thing that is coming. You're only a warner to the one who will gain fear of it eventually. Somehow they will have some fear instilled into them. كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَهَا. On the day on which they will see it, they will see that fire, they will see that hour arrive, it will be as though لَمْ يَلْبَثُوا إِلَّا عَشِيَّةً أَوْ ضُحَاهَا. They will remember this world, and they will say, we didn't stay in this worldly life. عَشِيَّةً. عَشِيَّة means the time when the sun starts setting, meaning it goes from its peak, the noon, it starts setting to Maghrib time. That period, that span is عَشِيَّة. Duha is the early morning, like Fajr time, all the way to noon. So they're going to say, we didn't stay in this worldly life, maybe one afternoon or one early afternoon. One morning to afternoon. That's the as far as we remember, in comparison to just this day, this hour. As-sa'a, that's the ha here. When they see that hour, their life will seem like one afternoon in comparison, subhanAllah. كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَهَا لَمْ يَلْبَثُوا إِلَّا عَشِيَّةً أَوْ ضُحَاهَا. The final thing, inshallah, we'll mention how the beginning of this surah is connected to the end of this surah, because that's a recurring study we're doing also. In the beginning, Allah spoke of the day. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةَ تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةَ. The day on which the rattling is going to occur. For that which is supposed to rattle, it's designed for rattling. And then followed by another, the first trumpet and then the second trumpet, right? At the end again, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ. They ask you about the hour. So it began with mention of the hour, it concludes with mention of the hour, tying the subject together, making it one cohesive discussion. Inshallah ta'ala, next week, by Allah's permission, I'll stick to my time limit, and we will discuss the next surah. Subhanak.